She has a big heart, your mom.
She's warm, but she's also kind of scary.
You can't be scary and warm.
I think you can. Your mom is.
Hi, folks. I'm Ignatiy Vishnevetsky.
And I'm Alex Dowd.
Today, we're talking about the nominees for Best Picture.
Welcome to the last of our very special Oscar editions of Film Club.
So we've got 9 nominees in this category. It's the most important category and is the category with probably the largest spread in quality and with the most films in it.
Yeah. Should I go through the nominees?
Yeah.
Let's see if I can do this. So we have Lady Bird. We have Call Me By Your Name. Phantom Thread. Get Out. The Shape of Water. The Post. Darkest Hour. 3 Billboards Outside Ebbing, Missouri. And Dunkirk. Great work, right?
I'm impressed.
Thank you.
And most of these films we've already talked about.
Yes.
Almost to death.
Yeah.
But it seems like there isn't a clear front runner here.
I don't think there is. I think that this is, in fact, I think this is one of the, I think we'll probably end up looking back on this as one of the years where there was the least sort of uncertainty going into Oscar night about what's going to win. I think there are a few that have a legitimate shot at winning. Mm-hmm. I think that for a while it seemed like 3 Billboards was the favorite. It had won a few precursor awards. It picked up the Golden Globe. Then the race just kind of started to shift, And I think now you could make a case for a number of films. I think The Shape of Water has a lot of support behind it. Mm-hmm. I think Get Out has a kind of zeitgeist push as well. I think that Lady Bird has a shot. I think Dunkirk has a shot. Mm. What does not have a shot?
I think The Post probably doesn't, yeah. But then you don't know. You never know. All the good movies could split the vote, and then the people with all the awful taste will vote for one.
I still don't think The Post is going to have the level of support it needs. Darkest Hour either.
Yeah. And The Post is not a terrible film. It is, but it is, I think, one of the weakest kind of late period Spielberg films.
Sure.
And I think the weakest of his examinations of American values and democracy on trial.
For sure.
I far prefer something like Bridge of Spies.
Yes. And I think Darkest Hour is sort of the most traditionally Oscar pick of all these
films.
Along
with The Post.
Yeah, I mean, those two. And I not coincidentally, I think both of those are the weakest two films in contention this year. Mm-hmm. I don't think either of them really have a shot. I think part of that is, we've talked a lot about this, about the changing makeup of the Academy, Mm-hmm. There was this kind of diversity push a couple years ago where a number of new members were added throughout the world. Basically,
and the thing is, not just American members, because the Academy has become significantly more international in its membership since that diversity push. Which basically involved inviting every major filmmaker in the world to join the Academy.
Right, so you have people like Ho Xiao Shen now voting for the Oscars.
Yeah.
And I think that Moonlight was sort of the test balloon, in a way, for this experiment. I think that a movie like Moonlight, basically the smallest Best Picture winner ever in terms of budget and scope of the production, but also a legitimate contender for the best movie of the year. I mean, how often does that happen where a movie where you could actually maybe say this is the best movie of the year wins Best Picture. Mm-hmm. But that result, I think, has thrown a wrench into
I think we'll probably make some predictions, but I feel like it would be, I wouldn't place money, on what could win.
Yeah. Well, what do you want to win?
I like Phantom Thread a lot. Mm-hmm. I like Dunkirk a lot. I like Lady Bird a lot. There are a lot of films in here that I like a lot.
It's sort of tiers in a way, mm-hmm. don't you think? I mean, there are the films.
Call Me By Your Name.
Yeah, right.
We won't forget, even though I think the Academy sort of skipped it in many categories where it deserved nominations.
That's another one that I think doesn't really have a snowball's chance of winning this. Gun to the head, what's your favorite here?
Probably Dunkirk. I mean, and I've talked about it before, because I do like a certain kind of, you could say, elemental craftsmanship. Mm-hmm. I think it's one of Nolan's, it's maybe neck and neck with The Prestige mm-hmm. as Nolan's best work to me, which I think The Prestige is a very different film. It's Nolan at his most Baroque, mm-hmm. And this is basically Nolan reduced down to his essence and pulling off nothing but suspense sequences, whereas that film is nothing but Nolan's misdirection for its entire running time.
But it's also such an audacious experiment, too, mm-hmm. in terms of the way it juggles timelines and what it's doing structurally. I feel like it might be the most ambitious of the 9 films nominated as well.
I mean, and there are parts where it basically works like a silent film.
Yeah.
I like Phantom Thread, obviously, as well. But I don't think that really has a chance.
See, but I don't know. I mean, of all the films that might get a real legitimate boost from this influx of serious art house auteurs from around the world, don't you think that maybe Phantom Thread is the one?
Yeah, probably.
You know? I mean, it had a surprisingly strong showing. Nobody was predicting it for Best Picture. Nobody was predicting it for Best Director. Certainly not Leslie Manville for Supporting Actress. These were all surprises, and that I think suggests that affection for this film within the Academy is maybe a little bigger than any of us
Their taste expected. Has been, I mean, you can tell that the taste is moving in an artier direction.
Yeah.
And the question is, as always, you know, how well does that actually represent Hollywood, or, you know, is the point of the Oscars to reward the best in Hollywood or to reward the best in film? I think often when it's the best in film, it seems remote to people.
Yeah.
But I think it's the greatest value of the Oscars has always been the ability to, and the one like really redeeming thing about the Oscars has been the ability to bring attention to filmmakers, to actors, to artists. Obviously, it's a big prestige thing. You know, a movie that's made hundreds of millions of dollars is not going to benefit at all from winning, whether or not it wins or loses an Oscar.
But people are seeing these movies. I mean, people are seeing Call Me By Your Name. People are seeing Phantom Thread. And some of that is because they're up for Oscars. Mm-hmm. And it can help, it can make careers. It can help people get funding for later projects. I think you're right that if the Oscars hold any currency, it's in their ability to get eyeballs on films and to get people work.
And we're seeing a very, I mean, talk about arties, but it's an increasingly, you could say, indie-fied Oscar field. We're seeing films that, there was definitely a period where indies really didn't, unless they were directed by someone who was already a big name.
Right.
You weren't going to see an indie by a first-time or a second-time director who hadn't already scored a hit in contention in the Oscars. And that has definitely changed. I mean, with Moonlight.
Sure.
And this year you've got Lady Bird, which is also A24, as was Moonlight, an indie production company and distributor that has somehow become something close to like a household name.
Yeah.
Based entirely on the quality of what they
put out. Yeah, it's a standard of quality. The sort of A24, it's become a brand, I think, in some respects, and a kind of trusted brand, people say.
And to think that it all started with a glimpse inside the mind of Charles Swan III. First ever A24 release.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. I think that I'm rooting for Lady Bird. I think that's my favorite of the nominees. It's not the most ambitious of the nominees. It's not the most sort of formally remarkable of the nominees. Mm-hmm. But I just think it's so truthful and so funny and so enduring. I've seen it, I think, four times now. And it improves with every viewing. I would love to see a movie continuing the sort of what Moonlight represented. I would love to see a movie of that size and that quality win Best Picture again.
It's a movie I wouldn't mind seeing win. And obviously, ever since last year, we feel like anything is possible. Mm-hmm. I mean, I won't rest. I think neither you nor I will be happy with the artiness of the Academy's membership until they begin nominating things like Nocturama.
Or The Lost City of Z.
Or The Lost, yeah.
Yeah.
Someday, if they add at least 200 to 300 more French people into the Academy, James Gray can finally get a nominee.
Or M. Night Shyamalan. He might get in.
Lady Bird is the one you're rooting for. Mm-hmm. I don't know what I'm exactly rooting for. I mean, like I said, I like Dunkirk the most out of the films, but Dunkirk doesn't need to win Best Picture.
That's true.
You know? I'd rather see a film with a lower budget by a less well-known filmmaker win.
Sure.
I know that the Oscars, it's a set of opportunities. You know, it's prestige. And that's always, I want to see that conferred on artists who haven't already gotten that.
Reynolds has made my dreams come true. And I've given him what he desires most in return. Every piece of me.